reproducible research in archaeology using R and RR tools. In this talk, we will show how archaeologists are changing their data analysis practices to make their research more reproducible and more open. We will introduce the RR tools package, which is our specific contribution to help with the challenge of making reproducible research in archaeology. Our project was developed, again, by ISAAKiel, by the group who took part in a summer school in 2017 in reproducible research in landscape archaeology at the Free University of Berlin, funded and jointly organized by the Excellence Cluster Topoi, the Collaborative Research Center in Kiel, and ISAAKiel. Our motivation for this topic arises from a profound change that we have been observing in how researchers analyze their data. Increasingly, we are seeing researchers publishing research that uses a programming language to calculate their models. Similarly, we see journal articles accompanied by scripts of programming languages so that readers can study the details of the data analysis methods. This is an important change away from using mouse-driven point-and-click software for data analysis. When archaeologists use software such as SPSS in PaaS, it is very difficult for them to share the details of their calculations. When readers cannot see the details of an analysis, it is difficult for them to be confident in the results described in the article. Also, for other researchers, it may be near impossible to implement the described methods in their own work, as they lack the details on how to come to the desired conclusions. Thus, using scripting language offers the chance of accelerating archaeological research by providing a way to retracing and checking published analyses, as well as explaining methods more efficiently. These are the main advantages of creating reproducible research, which we would like to encourage. In this presentation, we will briefly review some data showing change in the use of programming languages in the sciences generally, and in archaeology in particular. We focus on R, because this is by far the most widely used language in archaeology. Secondly, we will review how R is used by archaeologists to show the potential that using a programming language has for opening and accelerating archaeological research. And finally, we will introduce RR tools, which is designed to simplify and standardize the process of using R for archaeology, making research more open. So let's start with the current uses of R. This plot shows how data analysis is changing in the sciences more broadly towards the use of the R programming language. We searched the web of science, produced by Clarivate Analytics, for citation to the R program over the last 10 years, and filtered the results to the top 10 journals with the highest number of citations to this software. The purpose of this filtering step was to find areas of research where R is generally known, so we can see how its use is changing over time. Note that many articles that use R do not cite the R program, so these numbers are underestimates of the true use of R in science. We can make two major observations. First, the areas of science that have seen big growths in the use of R are ecology, evolution, and related biological sciences. This is especially significant for archaeologists because we quite often adapt methods for analysis as, for example, point pattern or statistical modeling from ecology and biology. We also see increases in multidisciplinary journals such as PLS1. Second, the scale of increase is quite impressive. Starting only in 2012, like some papers, some journals now have 20% of their articles citing R. So this is a substantial change in the way researchers are working in many fields. What about archaeology? Do we see changes there as well? Here are the results for the archaeological articles. We found 66 articles that cite R over the last 10 years. This is not complete, since these are just the journals tracked by the Web of Science, and archaeologists are prone to using many different kinds of journals. And I'm using my text. Yay! So what? And we have only 66 articles so far, and this is really not a lot. But we can also see in the slide that we don't have that many articles, journals that cite R have only started in the last 2 years, like in 2016-2017. We made a linear regression model on the articles in the Journal for Archaeological Sciences, which is the one journal that cites more than, which has more than 10 articles citing R in the last 10 years, and there is a very low R squared value, and what was it? Yeah, the p-value, which indicate that there is not a significant rise so far in archaeology articles citing R. I think this is what we wanted to say here, and I'm sorry, but this is weird. Whatever. Okay, there are three main points we can see in this as well. We can see that the topics that are covered in the journal articles are more scientific archaeology. So archaeology always has been between humanistic and scientific traditions in sciences. And so, of course, journals that publish research in statistical methods are more scientific. So this is what we call scientific archaeology, because in Germany it's sometimes difficult to say archaeology is not a science, whatever. And we can see that so there's also geoarchaeology there, and environmental archaeology, and more science-related things going on. What we can look at this further by taking the titles of the articles that publish R, used R, and titles of the of articles that don't cite R, and do a text binding analysis and see if the words in these titles differ. And so we can see that the words that appear here, far away from the red line in this area, are words that are used more in articles that do not cite R, and words that appear more on this part of the plot are title words that appear in articles citing R. So we can see there is quite a focus on lithic and more material approach, which is more like a technical aspect in archaeology, in technical analysis, whereas here there is more focus on certain time frames, for example. So this plot supports our initial observation that archaeologists using R tend to be doing more scientific archaeology. After this overview, how R is being used at the moment, we want to focus on the possibilities of making research reproducible using R. We now look at those archaeological papers using R that are demonstrating the potential of it for open and reproducible research. These papers are using R markdown for their research, which is shown in this figure. On the left side, we see a plain text document written in R markdown. This means that it has lines of codes in midst of lines of normal text. We can format the text with simple additions, such as the underscore to indicate italics, and the hash symbol for headings. These simple additions are markdown, which is a very easy markup language with plain text formatting syntax. And it is so designed that it can be converted into HTML, into docx, into PDF very easily. R markdown now allows us to mix R code and text in the same document. For example, here is a very small chunk of code in the right inside the text, and below this is a longer block of code below. This one was the one. Whatever. When this R markdown document is rendered or converted into this other kind of format, the inline code is created as the number that this line of code represents, and the block of code is replaced by the plot. We have found that some archaeologists are writing their entire journal articles using R markdown, and there's even later on a talk about someone who did his own thesis. This is very cool, I'm looking forward to that. The nice thing about people using R markdown for their articles is that they sometimes share their plain text markdown documents along with their publication. And this means that readers can see all of the details of the data analysis and all of the small decisions made along the way. This way, the analysis is much more easily reproducible for other people. And this is just a real-world example for our markdown in use. In our sample of R-citing archaeology articles, we identified 14 articles that include R script and data files, either in the supplementary materials or in a trustworthy data repository. This plot shows that although this number is quite small, it is increasing and suggesting that this is maybe the beginning of a new approach to how archaeologists share their research. The way in which these articles make their work reproducible is by making the data files available with their publication, making the R script files available with the publication, and using R markdown to add narrative text with the R code to give explanation and make it easier for readers to understand the analysis. Articles that have these three characteristics are part of a new paradigm in scientific communication, and with these 14 articles, we believe we may have identified the beginning of this behavior in archaeology. We think it will not be hard for archaeologists that already use R to make the transition to creating reproducible research by sharing their code and data. If this can be achieved, then we can realize some of the potential R really has for making research more open. As we studied the papers in our sample, we looked for common approaches to making and organizing the code and data files. We found that there were few common standards used by archaeologists in making their work reproducible, but rather a great variety of information presented in the code and data files. Some papers include code that will generate every figure and number in the text, while other papers only include code to produce one or two key figures. Looking further afield, we also reviewed current efforts towards improving the reproducibility of research in other disciplines. In reviewing the literature, we found several useful guides in diverse fields such as ecology or fluid dynamics. These guides describe several best practices that are not yet common in archaeology. So after looking at all this kind of data, we developed this new package called rrtools, which contains a small number of functions that automate many common analysis setup tasks. So, on this slide, we show the typical key functions in rrtools that a researcher would use to set up a compendium suitable for writing reproducible research. And each of these steps reflects a best practice that has been noted in our review of the literature. I will only focus now on the first five. Use compendium, the very first. This function creates a new directory for the research project and creates an R package within this directory. We use the R package structure as this is the standard which is widely recognized by R users. This means that people know where to look for data, where to look for code, and for dependencies and other information. This use MIT license. This function creates a copy of the MIT software license to the compendium. And this is important because it clears the expectations about what is allowed to do with the code and that the creator of the code is not responsible for any problems, and this expectations about the relationship between the reader and the author. DevTools use GitHub, creates a Git version control system. Git is the current state of the art for version control, and it creates a repository on the GitHub website as well as a repository on your own computer. Using version control is important because it allows the author to time travel back to earlier states of the analysis if you, for example, take a dead end path. It's also important for making collaboration smooth, and because this way many people can work on a set of files without losing track of what the most recent version is. Also, it's nice to have a remote backup. The GitHub repositories can be kept private if so desired, until the work is published. Use README creates a README document, which is quite well known, I think. And use analysis is this function creates a set of folders according to the best practices for organizing a typical research project. We recognize that this file structure won't be perfect for every project, but we know that it will suit quite a lot, and it will make at least the user think about how to organize their files logically and according to best practices. And this is what we want to present further. This is just the file structure rrtools gives us. And we would just want to point out two main points. We keep the data, the raw data, separate from data that is created or derived during the analysis, just to make sure never to overwrite anything. And we keep the data separate from the methods, and so code in a separate directory to data, because this makes it much more easier for anyone else to finding and navigating through this, finding things and navigating through this compendium. So to summarize, we have shown a bibliometric analysis that reveals substantial change in the use of the R programming languages in science generally, and we saw that especially ecology and evolutionary science have embraced this change. We have also shown that archaeologists have taken up R, but to a much lesser degree, and that it's most common in the most scientific aspects of archaeology. We also identified a small subset of archaeology papers that use R to make their work fully reproducible, and this is a great potential for other archaeologists to making their work more open. And this would be a good thing for archaeology in general, we believe. And also we have presented our freely available R package rrtools, which is designed to make it easier for researchers in archaeology and other fields to make their research more open. We hope this will help to realize some of the potential to make archaeological research more reproducible. Thank you for your attention.